This video is sponsored by Control Plane. Previously on City Fast Fresh Deploys with Rust.
I'm gonna make a new database on Amazon. This is the silliest use case for a Postgres database, which is storing our source code. Like, we're basically using Postgres like Git. The way you should attack this website is to hit the deploy endpoint, which I haven't secured in any way. We're gonna do a three-way split. It ran in 600 milliseconds. All right, I'm happy with that. We want to fetch the new revision, unpack it in the folder, and launch Deno and like changing where the proxy proxies to. So how do we do this? Other child is gonna be none. We should have a channel. Yes. We're making a channel so that when we get a Postgres notification, we send something to here. And then here we have a loop. Okay, wait needs a mutable reference on the child. So if we want to eventually kill the child, what we need to do. So let me try and explain what's going on. We're doing blue-green deploys. So let's say we have blue. We're currently routing connections to blue. But then a new revision comes in. So what we do is we start another instance of the fresh app, listening on another port, and we're going to call that green. And we're going to start routing connections. Instead of going to blue, they're going to go to green. And eventually, all the connections to blue are going to be finished, and we can kill blue. But that means we have a child process that we need to do two things to. We need to wait for it, because it's the only way to know if it crashed. It's going to return with a non-zero exit code. And also, it's the only way to reap child processes on Linux. Otherwise, it's going to stay as a zombie forever. And we need to be able to kill it. But as you can see, the wait method takes a mutable reference to self here. And the kill method also does take a mutable reference to self, which means the Rust interface, both in the standard library and in Tokyo, is more restrictive than what Linux lets you do. On Linux, processes, you just get a numeric identifier for them. You just get a U32, that's a process ID. And then from different threads, you can call different functions. You can call kill, which just sends a signal. You can call wait, PID. And we want to be doing those both at the same time. The Tokyo interface doesn't let us do that, but we're going to work around that by taking this PID and using a libc function directly to send a signal to the process. Another way we could have solved this is, because now we're using Tokyo and this wait function here is asynchronous, we could have canceled the wait and then called kill and then started waiting again. It's a little more complicated to set up, and I didn't think of it in the moment. This is why we're not doing this. We're actually calling the libc functions directly. But if you don't want to like drop down to libc, this is the thing that we could have done. Okay, let's do one piece at a time. So wipe the temp, dear. Yes, absolutely. With TokyoFS, please. Yes. Mm-hmm. So again, we have to derive from row the SQLite thing. Download all the files. Write them to the temp dir. So it is going to be complicated. We're going to have path and hash and data. It's right about that. Actually, we need the revision files idea. Okay, this revision files for this revision. Path and hash from revision files for revision ID is this. Yes, that seems fine. Okay, this gets the data, and then temp path join. This is almost right. This is where this path function comes in. And the paths that we have right now are relative to dot, which is unfortunate, but it shouldn't mess up anything. Because if you do slash dot slash, it's like it was just slash. You're just moving against the current directory. We should probably be printing something here. Okay, because we're going to be looking out for that in the logs to make sure everything works fine. So as I'm editing this, I realize I posted cringe on the internet, because we're doing 1, 2, 3, and this one is n plus 1. We're doing 3 queries that could be a single query. So I'm going to try and do it in a single query just to show you what it would look like. Okay, so this is what it would look like. So we do a single query, and we need to start with the innermost query, which is just selecting the from latest revision table, which again is a weird table because it's just a global. So we get the revision idea from here, and then we use that to filter revision files, and it's joined with the files table, and then we just select path and hash and data. And this is also something I didn't show in the video. It's that there's a fetch many method here that returns a stream. I had to add the futures crates to get this convenience next method here. But then for every item in the stream, we get exactly what we wanted, which is all the files. So I think the reason I didn't do this is because I was expecting to do the thing where if we already have downloaded some files, we have a cache of files that we've already downloaded. So we don't need to, like, if the code is actually quite large and we already have a working deploy, then the difference between this deploy and the next deploy is actually a small amount of files, and we don't want to re-download everything. We just want to maybe copy them, maybe do a symlink or something. But yeah, this could all be a single query, and this is what it looks like. Then again, it's not a video about SQL, but yeah, no. I just wanted to show that it's possible. All right, we're very close. So this is a dirty way of doing this, but I think we're just going to use libc-kill. So other child PID. It's going to be an option U32, and it's going to start as none. So we start Deno. Now we have a child. Now we switch to the new revision. Mm-hmm. Kill the other child, if any. Yes. Perfect. Okay. And notify Rx. Oh, because it's just looping right now. Yeah. Then we just send one here. Like so. I think we have all the pieces. Oh, the thing we missed is that working directory should be our temp path. Okay. Aha, all the top level files are working, but this is in a subdirectory, so it's not working. So what we actually want to do is path.parent, and then Tokyo creator all await unwrap, yes. But it's doing the thing, it's getting the files from Postgres and it's putting them in TMP something. Look at this. It recreated the thing here. Now it says listening. Yeah, okay. It says accepted connection. I mean, now we actually need to run a deploy to see the magic happen. Okay. So it's doing a thing, it's killing the old child. Oh yeah, it wrote everything, port 3001. That seems to work. 3002, it seems to work. Okay, so we should change something here. Yeah, it does work. Cool. All right. So what's happening here is that this thing is checking with Postgres to see which files are missing or different because everything is content addressed. Then it's uploading things that are missing. It's making a new revision. It's marking it as latest. The deploy ingest server is generating a notification, which is breaching any web instances, which is then checking the latest revision, downloading all the files, even the ones that it already has, writing them to a temp directory and running Deno there, listening on one of two ports, and then routing all the traffic to that the currently active deploy. So we have all the things. We just need to deploy it now. So because we just pushed a new image, I'm going to force a deploy on both of these. Force redeploy. Force redeploy. I'm going to take close look at the logs from refresh because it should be downloading the sources from our production Postgres instance. So migration's deployed, it's got the latest revision, downloaded all the files, wrote them to a temp directory, launched Deno, and so this should be up and running. And it is. But remember, we haven't deployed our latest fresh code to the production Postgres yet. So this is why we're seeing this message here instead of the latest that's here. But it does work. Is the JavaScript also working? Sometimes it struggles a little bit. Yes, it is working. Cool. Now, if we keep all the logs there, perfect. Feel like I'm really in the matrix now. So now we're going to deploy again, but the ingest address is going to be the production thing. I can get rid of the, okay, so it's already done. So, oh, it's doing the blue deploy. Look, it's doing the blue deploy here. It's already working. See how fast that was? Yeah, it's got the payload and everything. All right, this is great. Now we can actually write a web app and have working deploys. Ah, this is so good. And so this, now I'm going to actually scale this up. Let's add some locations. Do one in GCP and one in Azure, just to make sure that it works across all three clouds. I'm going to save that. Now we're going to have more instances. We go back to the workload here. Yeah, okay, it's deploying. Do we still have an old deployer run? Yeah, we have version 9. Ah, oh, God. Okay, where I'm going to force a stop and then start again. Get rid of this one. This is an annoying bug. This is going to get rid of that old deploy. So I debated leaving that in, but because it happened 3 or 4 times during the course of recording that video, I thought I'd leave it in because it also shows the workaround for this. I'm assuming it's a silly bug and they're going to fix it as soon as I report it to them. But yeah, it is what it is for now. I had to stop and restart several times to get rid of old versions of the workload. Okay, all three locations are up. You can see that this one's really fast for me because it's really close by. Let's look at this in the dev tools. Yeah, time 500 milliseconds to get the JavaScript here. But if we look at here, yeah, 59, 82. It's faster for us from Europe than it is from Central US and US East. Actually, Central US is not that bad. You know, I could live with that. I forgot to mention something important. So we have three separate endpoints here, one per location. And that's great because it lets us measure latency, it lets us troubleshoot any location-specific issues, and as you can see, they all resolve to separate IP addresses here. Here's the EU Central one on Amazon, here's the Central US one on Azure, US East one on Google Cloud Platform. But there's also a global endpoint that's load balanced, so it's using GeoDNS to direct users to the closest location, and you can see in my case, it's EU Central 1. So if I do a performance test here, we're going to get some numbers. And what you have to keep in mind with those numbers is that it's currently only using 25 millicores and 32 megabytes of memory usage. It's scaled down significantly because I'm heavily optimizing for cost. So with that in mind, you can see that actually the P90 is 200 milliseconds. So is the P95. P99 is 300. I would want better performance out of that for an actual real use case. So what I do is simply raise the minimum CPU usage and maybe keep at least one replica per location. This is all stuff you can set in the options up here. Also, in the interest of transparency, here is what my usage graph looks like since I started doing research on there. This is my self-hosted analytics thing. It's costing me 17 cents per day. This is when I started recording the video. You can see it went all the way up to 83 cents a day. And now that it's scaling back down, you can see we're at a projected 16 cents a day. So, you know, if you could spare a donation, I'm really in deep right now. So this one's running on AWS, this one is running on Azure, and this one is running on Google Cloud. And we can deploy to all three of these really fast. And let's actually prove that. And that's exactly what we'll do in, you guessed it, the next and final part of this series. It's been so long. Do you remember when the series started? Gods, we were young then. But anyway, yeah, all the rest is done and we have an actual useful fresh app to build, and I'll publish the sources and everything. It's gonna be great.